Yeah, that would be number one rule, get a good ball to hit. Rogers Hornsby told me that. Again, going back to my little question that I used to ask all the hitters. And finally, I met Roger Hornsby. And I said, what's the most important thing for me to become a good hitter? He said, get a good ball to hit. And he was 100% right.
Hit .358 lifetime.
Yeah, I thought...
Averaged .400 over a five-year span in the 20s. Unbelievable.
What a hitter. And the funny part of it is that, you know, he hit a lot in St. Louis. It's as good a park to hit in that there was, especially for somebody right center, left center.
Right.
And not that it was so far in right center, but it was far in left center, but he was a line drive hitter. But the big thing is, he hit .382 or something in St. Louis, and they traded him. And I said, I'm just going to look this record up. I said, I'm going to look him up. Being in that good park all the time, I'm going to look him up and see what he did the next year in the Giants' Polo Grounds. He hit .378 Polo Grounds the very next year.
People used to say about you, Fenway Park, bad for a left-handed hitter. In fact, that old thing was, why not trade DiMaggio for Williams? DiMaggio shoots at the Green Monster. Williams gets the short porch and ride a Yankee Stadium. But in truth, Fenway is a good hitter's park, and all left-handed hitters, Yaz, Fred Lynn, Pete Runnels, Boggs, all the left-handed hitters there always hit higher there than on the road because you have other factors that help you there.
Well, the big factor for me was that it helped me wait because I knew that if I was a little bit late, I had the short porch. And even though I didn't hit out that much time, it gave me that psychological thinking up there. And so as a result, I could wait. And as a result of that, I wasn't fooled. So I looked like heck. Everything was batting practice.
Who do you see today? You say, yeah, I like that guy's style. I'd like to play with that guy.
Well, I see so much talent today. I really do. So much talent today. Big, strong guys that swing a bat pretty good. But they don't know that little game as good as they should know it between the pitcher and himself. They don't hit according to the count. They don't hit according to the score. They don't hit according to what they did the last two or three times at the plate. They don't hit according to the wind. And so I remember the first guy told me that, too. That was Hornsby. And I kind of said, when? Why, certainly. Why try to pull a ball right into a death? Make that the day you're going to beat straight away if you can.
You know what you're saying, though? You're saying they don't care as much as I care. Well, they're not obsessed like I was obsessed.
Well, it's a little harder for them today, too, I think. For number one reason, their schedule is, I never had guys like you bothering me for interviews, this kind of thing. I've been on here an hour already. But they're everything is involved all day long. You can't get out of the hotel. You can't go over here. You can't, you know, everything's a hustle bustle. And so, sure, there's a lot of things that make the modern athlete have problems that I didn't have in my era.
What do you think would have become of you without baseball? What if you broke
Boy, I get scared. I get scared thinking about it. And that's the reason you have to realize how lucky you've been in your life. The things turned out. Ain't I lucky I wasn't born in Idaho, up in some little town in the hills. Great hunting, great fishing, nice people, no place to play. I'd probably have been an outfitter or a guide or something, you know. Hell of a shot.
Were you unhappy as a kid? It's people who theorize you had an unhappy childhood and baseball was an
outlet. There were things of a personal nature that bothered me, and I think that happens in life, and things that I wish that could have been a little easier, but maybe after seeing the news as easily as you see it today and see everything that happens in the world, you got to think just being in America, you're pretty lucky.
Your dad wasn't around that much. Your mom worked for the Salvation Army.
Yeah.
And was kind of obsessed with that in her
That's
own way.
That's right. And there wasn't too many people at home. And I had a chance to do what I wanted to do. Luckily, there weren't the temptations that have been in the last 30, 40 years with this dope and all the rest of it. But that playground was important to me. And I had a chance to play. And there was kids to play all the time. Every night, there was an old Mexican family, Talamantes, and they had five kids. They all got into professional baseball, and the old man was out there every night playing pepper. I got a chance to be in those games. I think it's the single most easiest way to develop yourself as a hitter. Pepper, 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 pepper. And most
Make
guys
your wrist
don't
quick.
Even know Well, it gets you bat on the ball and gets you hitting the ball right and controlling the bat. And they don't even play it now very much. They don't even play Pepper, and that's certainly a fault.
This is an overused word, but there's a certain integrity about you. Even if people disagreed with you, there's a certain consistency through all the years about you. Do you have a personal code that you could explain? What's your personal code?
Somebody said the other day, he said, I don't believe in God, but he just said, I believe in good. I have my own way of knowing whether I'm doing things right or whether I'm going to be proud of some of the things, unless a lot of things I've done I haven't been proud of. But I do believe in doing things right, being the best you can, treat people as you'd like to have them treat you. And I think the great thing I like to see in any person, I said this to my kids and I've said it to anybody that I'm around, that I like enthusiasm. You show me enthusiasm and boy, I'll show you, and you had it and you must have had it. This guy that's successful must have had it. You got to have enthusiasm or you're going to sleep it away.
I've never met a great baseball player who didn't have to work harder at learning to play baseball than anything else he ever did. To me, it was the greatest fun I ever had, which probably explains why today I feel both humility and pride, because God let me play the game and to learn to be good at it. Proud because I've spent most of my life in the company of so many wonderful people. So in closing, I'm grateful, and I know how lucky I was to have been born in America and had a chance to play the game I love, the greatest game of them all, baseball.
We're back with part two with Ted Williams tomorrow night. Please be here. See you later. Hope you were with us last night. We're forging right ahead. What do you regret the most?
I regret the most, really, I've had 10 times more credit for being in the service than anybody else. I was only in four and a half plus years.
But those are, forgive me for interrupting,
they were
four
big
and a half
years.
Plus
All
years,
right. Okay.
Prime years, 521 home
yeah.
runs. You factor in what you average,
yep.
You're coming close to Ruth's record.
Okay, but then my biggest regret. You know, here's a funny thing. Well, I'm not going to bring this up, but I'll tell you that my biggest regret is that 1949, I thought for sure I was going to be the most valuable player in 48, and I wasn't. 49, I didn't think I was going to get it, and I got it. And 50, I'm ahead of all, either one of those years in 50. Don't the All-Star game with this average, that many home runs, that many runs added in. Bang, I get it. I go into the fence. I hurt my left elbow. I'm out there practically the rest of the year. But that is my biggest personal single regret as far as my actual playing is concerned. Certainly you always regret if you played as long as I did and you're only in one World Series. You got to regret that. And that we didn't win that World Series, and we should have. And but those are two of the biggest regrets.
1946, the only World Series you got in, losing 7 games, 4-3 in the 7th game at Sportsman's Park against the Cardinals, and you, arguably the greatest hitter of all time, you go 5-for-20. Of course, Stan Musial, who hit .365 that year for the Cardinals, went 6-for-24 or something like that, but when you win, it erases it.
That's right.
And then people said, hey, Williams doesn't come through in the clutch.
Well, all I can tell you is that I played over a period of 25 years in the minors, in the big leagues over a period of 22 years. You can put tab on anybody. Dempsey didn't fight anybody. Lewis didn't fight anybody. Williams didn't hit in a couple of games, so they put that moniker on you. And all I can tell you is that I'm doing, or I'm involved in quite a study of the greatest hitters that ever lived. And the formula we use on everybody, no matter what they did or where they did it, the formula we use on everybody proves, I think, conclusively who were the greatest hitters in baseball. And despite what anybody might say, I'm 1, 2, 3 in everything.
Well, you know, as I said to you on the radio a few years ago, you would have to strategically place as many hits as you got. It'd be impossible not to get a lot of clutch hits.
You got
too damn many hits. But let's put it bluntly. All things considered, given the fact that you span, after all, your career began only 4 years after Babe Ruth's ended. It goes all the way up to 1960. It takes into account a new era, relief pitching, integration, night ball. Considering all that and the 344 average, second slugging average behind Babe Ruth, highest on-base percentage ever, the home runs per time at bat, could you make a case for yourself as the best hitter who ever lived?
I wouldn't like to say that I could make a case for myself. I love it when they say he's one of the greatest hitters that ever lived, and when I'm put in the category of Ruth and Gehrig and Simmons and Fox and Hornsby and Aaron and Mays and DiMaggio, that's good enough for me. But I want to tell you something. This is research for you. In the 50s, and I played till 60, but in the early 50s, Look magazine, pretty reputable magazine, highly thought of and everything else, wrote one of the biggest articles that even in 1953 or 4 or 5, that I had more game-winning hits than anybody in baseball history, right then.
So it's
and after that, it got to where the sacrifice fly from third base, I never got any chance for that. Let's walk him and get a double play. Or pitch so tough that it looks like we pitched to him, but we didn't.
Here's a little-known fact, by the way. The sacrifice fly rule, in terms of scoring and how it affects your batting average, not in effect in 1941. Yeah. You had six, in effect, sac flies. You would have batted .412.
That's right. And then they did change that so that the two later hitters, Britt, great hitter, and
Carew,
great hitter, wouldn't have fared quite as well without the advantage of the sacrifice fly. And those hitters were more likely to get a chance probably to hit with a man on third than I did.
Can you imagine a guy today coming into the last day of the regular season with a batting average of .399 plus that would round to .400? The pressure's on him from his agent, yeah, from his sponsors, yeah, to say, don't go out there. You're a .400 hitter. You'll market this into the next century. I mean, there was enough pressure on you,
yeah,
after all. No one had done it since Bill Terry, I guess 11 years earlier. No one has done it since. But you went out and played in the doubleheader against the Philadelphia A's.
I never honestly ever give it a thought. I didn't even think about not playing. I walked around Philadelphia all night, pretty near, with the clubhouse kid, worried about it. And then Cronin suggested he... that day.
Joe Cronin, the manager.
Joe Cronin, the manager, suggested that day, and I never give it a thought. I said, certainly I'm playing, you know. And I could have been unlucky not done it, but I was lucky and they fell in.
You went 6-for-8, right?
Yep.
In a doubleheader.
Yep, yep,
six
yep.
for eight.
That wasn't bad. I liked that.